A colleague of mine once said that a normal IT architect envisions how a system will work, whereas a security architect envisions how a system will fail. Really turns out that a security architect has to do both. They have to figure out how the system will work so that they can figure out what all the different failure cases might derive from that. Well, you may have heard of a postmortem, where an analysis is done after a project is completed in order to extract lessons that can be learned and applied to future projects. Well, how about the idea of a pre-mortem, where we start with the idea that the system we're now designing has already failed, and now backtrack to figure out why. Then build in the mitigations so that all of this stuff doesn't happen before the bad guys actually attack. A skilled security architect would use their knowledge, their experience, their imagination to envision how a system might fail.
In other words, they have to think like a hacker.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And Patrick, that's essentially what you do for a living, right?
That's exactly right.
You're an ethical hacker.
I am indeed.
Okay. Well, so what we're going to be doing in this series, we've got three videos. We're going to take a look at what it means to be an ethical hacker, what does the job involve, and how can I get a career in this particular space? So Patrick, you work for IBM's X-Force. What is that organization about? What do they do?
Sure. X-Force is made up of three primary sections. The first one I would start with is Intel. These are the folks that do lots of research and investigations to figure out what type of things are real bad guys out there doing.
Yeah, so they might be looking at the dark web and stuff like that in order to figure out what's happening and alert people, right?
Exactly. The next one would be IR. This is also known as incident response. These are the folks that you call if you have a breach in your network and you need some help figuring out what happened, how do we get the bad guys out of there. They're your 911 for an incident.
Gotcha. And they can help you post-incident as well as pre-incident, sort of planning for what a disaster might be and what might occur, right?
Exactly.
Okay. All right, and then the third group?
Third group is red, so that's where I work. These are the folks that you call if you want to figure out, how is a hacker going to break into my network? So these are our professional hackers that we're going to come in and help you see where are my vulnerabilities and how are the bad guys going to exploit those.
Gotcha. Gotcha. And with that group, then, that's, as you said, where you are. So tell us, what's your title?
Sure. My title is the Global Head of Adversary Simulation. I run a group of these hackers.
That sounds pretty cool. So another way of thinking about that is it's essentially a red team operator. Right?
That's exactly right.
Okay. So now that I've mentioned this idea of teams, let's talk about what these teams are. So we've got teams on here, and we've got red teams, and we got blue teams. What's the difference?
Sure. So our red team is our pretend bad guys. These are acting as our adversary. They're the ones who are testing our defenses. The blue team is our defensive team. So they're the ones who are responding and making sure, hey, the bad guys can't get in.
Gotcha. And those terms kind of come from military background. Is that right?
That's exactly right. The military coined these terms quite a long time ago to sort of begin the idea of, hey, we need to make sure we have a pretend bad guy so we get a good thorough test of our defensive capabilities.
So it's that adversarial simulation. You've got the defense guys and you've got the attack guys, and you're running exercises, hopefully before the bad guys get around to doing it.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. So we've got teams, we've got colors, we've got hats. We like to use this term informally to refer to different types of hackers. And there are good hackers and bad hackers. And so we refer to them as what kinds?
So we've got our white hat and our black hat hackers.
Yeah. And what's the main difference between those?
The primary difference would be permission. So the white hats are the ones that you call and ask to break into your network. The black hats are the ones who are doing it without permissions.
Yeah. And I would say a big difference amongst those is these guys get paid and these guys steal. So that's one distinction. But if you start looking at career earnings, well, the possibility is you get a nice collection at one point in time and then you go to jail. Whereas this career path, you keep earning and keep earning and keep earning, and you stay out of jail. So maybe this is the better long-term career decision.
Yeah, there's a lot of possibility for career progression at this. I think if you go down the path of black hat, sort of captain, like you said, probably end up in jail.
Yeah. So Patrick, you're an ethical hacker. What goes into that? Let's dissect this a little bit.
Sure. It's a topic you can imagine is quite big, and there's lots of ways that you can think about it. But one way we could approach it is to think of it in this pyramid of the pieces of a testing program when it comes to ethical hacking. At the bottom of that pyramid, we might put vulnerability scanning. This is your more automated type of testing, where we're looking at the big picture, trying to capture as much data as possible and understanding where all the vulnerabilities are. Right on top of that, we might put penetration testing. This is where you're starting to bring in your skilled testers to look at specific systems, maybe web applications or hardware. And they're going to be able to test those things and understand, you know, are they exploitable? What's the impact of those exploits? And give you the information about how to fix those things.
A lot of this stuff is automated using tools and things like that, right?
I'd say it's right down the middle. So supported by tools, but with a skilled person behind them.
Okay, gotcha. And then the top of the pyramid?
That's where you're going to put your red teaming. So this is where we're pretending to be a true adversary. Think, you know, everything from nation state to ransomware operators. How do they work, and are they going to be able to break in? What's the effect of those types of things?
Yeah, and this is where you, as global head of adversary simulation, you and your team are going to exist in this space, right?
That's exactly right.
Yeah, so these are the kinds of things that you would want to do to put your system through its paces. You wouldn't take a system and just put it into production without ever testing it, right? Well, you wouldn't put a system without testing it for security. Look for all its vulnerabilities. Bring in skilled ethical hackers like Patrick and his team in order to figure out whether you have covered all the bases here or not. So what we've done so far in this video is we basically looked at what's involved in the role. And in the next video, we'll take a look at a little more deeper dive into what's involved in the job. What are some of the tasks that go into this? And then the third video in this series, we'll take a look at how you can go about getting a career in this space. So like and subscribe so that you're aware when future videos come out in the series.